Flying with the elite airmen of the Third Reich on Wings of the Luftwaffe.
Floating like some black monster from the sea is the only example ever made of a Blohmann Voss 238. The aircraft is notable in many ways, but primarily because it was the largest aircraft produced in wartime Germany. And at the time, it was the largest flying boat in the world. It represented the pinnacle of achievement for its manufacturers. Had the war not ended when it did, the Third Reich could have had hundreds of these enormous aircraft filling the skies over Allied territory, and even stretching the sting of war to the safe shores of North America. Large flying boats offered the Third Reich tremendous range and the ability to carry large payloads. They could have compensated for its lack of capital ships and other major surface vessels. Working in conjunction with submarines to refuel them, flying boats like the 238 and its smaller cousin, the 222, may even have been able to reach the United States on bombing missions, giving a much-needed boost to the morale of those at home. The 238 never reached America, but 15 years earlier, another mammoth German flying boat did. In 1929, the Dornier DOX was the largest plane in the world. The brainchild of Professor Cornelius Dornier, it had 12 massive engines, 6 facing forward and 6 aft. Engineers could reach them via tunnels in the huge wings. Monitoring and synchronizing the engines was a function more akin to that of a ship's engineer, and was a full-time job for more than one man. It was seen as an obvious competitor to ocean-going liners, another way for wealthy travelers to commute between countries and see the world from above the sea, rather than on it. Up to 60 passengers could be cosseted in a high degree of luxury, with attention to their every need, while the crew navigated this behemoth craft across the Atlantic. Before Dornier established his reputation with conventional aircraft, he worked at the Zeppelin Airship Company, which later built the Hindenburg, an airship that carried no more people and at a much slower pace, 7 years later. Arriving as it did barely 10 years after the First World War, this invasion by a former enemy was to be well received by the American people. But there were many former allies in Europe who were concerned about the DOX's potential. For although it was really an airliner without any aggressive potential, it came to symbolize Germany's re-emergence from the shadow of the First World War and a rebirth of its much envied engineering tradition. Cynical speculated that if 60 people could be flown across the Atlantic in sheer luxury, then perhaps several hundred could be accommodated in more austere conditions. Possibly this could have military implications. Another peaceful invasion to American shores occurred in 1931. This time the Italians, arriving with a fleet of catamaran flying boats, demonstrated again that the Atlantic could be breached by using a similar route to the Germans. 2 years later, they repeated their achievement, but this time by coming in from the north. They were, of course, both goodwill missions. After all, Italy had been America's ally in the First World War. mammoth DOX had a two-engine forerunner called the Dornier Val, or Whale. Although much smaller, it displayed similar lines to its gigantic brother. But the Val could only carry about 10 passengers. One of its functions was as a mail plane, shipping letters and parcels from one continent to another on a fast and regular basis. The Val was designed immediately after the First World War, but due to the Treaty of Versailles, was not completed. In fact, it took an Italian company working in conjunction with Dornier to complete the first Val in 1923. Later, it was built in Germany, as well as in Japan, Holland, and Spain. Over 300 of these redoubtable flying boats were to be built before production ceased in the mid-30s. Some, like this one departing from East Africa, pioneered the transatlantic airmail run down to Brazil. Of course, aircraft of this size never had the range of the DOX or the security of 12 engines. Nevertheless, they braved their way to South America, stopping to refuel from special tender ships anchored mid-Atlantic. These vessels were specially constructed to support the Val's transatlantic mission. The pilots referred to these stop-offs as double refueling. While the Val was tanked up, the pilot got a strong drink too. There were only a few of these specialist tender ships available for the task, and one was always on duty, serving 12 months at a time, just a speck in the vast Atlantic. Precise navigation was a must, for this was literally the only lifeline for the Val's crew. After the pilot beached his flying boat on the ship's ramp, it would be quickly hoisted by crane to place it on board for service and refueling. It's interesting that the nautical connection with flying boats was so strong that different sized Vals were referred to by their tonnage. This is a 10-ton model and the largest one produced. The Val, like any other flying boat, consumed much of its precious fuel in the all-out burst of power needed at takeoff to lift the plane out of the water. To relieve this problem, tender ships were equipped with a pneumatic catapult arrangement. Once refueling and repairs were complete, the Heinkel-built pneumatic catapult would fling the 10 tons of aircraft into the air in about 2 seconds flat. By 1934, Lufthansa was operating the service on a regular basis across the South Atlantic. Sindicato Condor, as it was called, pioneered the opening up of a whole continent for communication with the Europeans. By that time, it employed 5 flying boats and 2 tender ships. Collectively, they flew over 320 transatlantic flights with the loss of only 1 flying boat. The service was finally curtailed at the outbreak of the Second World War. Apart from providing an effective transoceanic mail service, the exercise also demonstrated how it was possible for flying boats to liaise with small tender vessels midway across the Atlantic, effectively doubling the aircraft's potential range. The flying boat's cousin is the seaplane. Sometimes a conventional land-based aircraft like this Junkers Ju-52 transport, merely with its undercarriage replaced by 2 floats to make it seaworthy. In the pre-war days, when most of the limited runways were little more than grass strips, the longer, smooth surface of still water provided an acceptable alternative for towns with good harbors. By 1933, Germany was rising from the humiliation of Versailles, and its people had been smitten by a new ideology that offered to restore the nation to its former glory. But the price was total subservience to one man and the party to whom he dictated. During the rallies that followed, the technologies of the new war machine were displayed. Technologies that concentrated on the air and on the ground. Germany's sea power was still in its infancy. Shortly to be partners in fascism, the Italians did have a substantial navy, and this service had already developed float planes for maritime reconnaissance work in support of the fleet. Unlike the Italians, or the Japanese and Americans who followed the same line, German designers preferred twin-float seaplanes to do their naval reconnaissance work. Small numbers of Heinkel HE-60s were seen supporting Germany's limited fleet. A more improved offering was the Arado AR-95, which first flew in 1936 and remained in service until 1944. You can see under the aircraft's fuselage one of the advantages that seaplanes have over their floatplane cousins. Aerial torpedoes are easier to carry and fire with greater accuracy from the centerline position. Aircraft like the 95 could be quickly adapted for torpedo deployment by fitting this support and ejection system. When the deployment system was not in use, it was simply stored ashore, thus reducing the plane's overall weight. Clever devices like these turn simple biplane aircraft like the Arado AR-95 into dangerous maritime raiders. The next step was to load the 1,500-pound torpedo. The 95 could carry quite a variety of ordnance, including bombs, depth charges, and mines. The overall payload was small compared with other aircraft, but one well-placed missile would do. Some 95s were to see limited combat service, operating in the near reaches of the Baltic Sea, where they would have patrolled coastal areas seeking to ensure German dominance in the region. Perhaps a greater service that the 95 offered the Third Reich was that it paved the way for what was hoped to be Arado's most successful biplane, the AR-195, an aircraft aimed at a most specific mission with Germany's long-awaited aircraft carrier. Certainly the handling qualities of this sturdy little aircraft would have been taken into account in such an important decision. Biplane had not been successful, then its first monoplane, designed to perform almost the same task, certainly was. The 196 adopted many of the features of the 195 and was first tested in various forms, including a floatplane configuration which supported the aircraft in the centerline position, with additional assistance from two outrigger floats to maintain stability. Probably as a result of the impact of landing, the heavy engine sheared the mounts. This would have caused the plane's crew some very anxious moments and highlights the extra dangers to which naval aviators were exposed. Clearly, these men had little time to think and barely enough to react. Engine mounts broke, so too did the fuel lines. Petrol would have cascaded down onto the hot cylinders of the air-cooled engine, causing a potentially lethal situation, from which both crew members were lucky to have escaped. Failures are not uncommon in the risky business of landing planes at sea. The fact that this plane survived after the fire was silent testimony to just how rugged the 196 really was. It was that basic rugged construction that saw the 196 adopted as the standard seaplane by the beginning of the war. And it was employed on all of the major ships capable of supporting aircraft, It played an important role in observation and light attack duties. During the lead-up to the outbreak of war, Germany had concentrated heavily on building up U-boat fleets, submarines that would later patrol the Atlantic, devastating Britain's lifeline to America. The aim was to starve the island nation into submission, a goal they almost reached. However, the Third Reich did possess some capital ships. Vessels like the Bismarck, Tirpitz, and Scharnhorst were quite substantial, and during the early part of the war caused the British considerable problems. But the Royal Navy had one type of vessel that Germany didn't possess, and that was the aircraft carrier. In actual fact, Germany did order one that would have been called the Zeppelin, and in 1937 even used the converted steamship Griffin as a miniature test bed to develop a carrier for aircraft. The Griffin offered a small catapult arrangement, which was less sophisticated than that used by the Vaal in the South Atlantic. But it was enough for a light aircraft like the Fieseler Storch to test the ideas needed to build a fully fledged carrier. Gradually, the catapult is stressed as the plane is pulled backwards by an aft line. When fully under tension and the pilot has enough revs available, the catapult would be released, hurtling the little Storch into the air. Basic physics, but very necessary for a nation with no previous experience in aircraft carriers, and in the late 1930s with a compelling desire to have them. The Griffin's primitive flight deck was no wider than the ship's hull, making the pilot's positioning of the aircraft on approach a very demanding business. If you look carefully, you'll see how close the left wheel goes to the edge of the deck. Overcompensation, particularly on a rolling deck, could actually spell disaster, even with a slow-moving light aircraft like the Storch, which in a strong headwind could almost hover. The limits of this type of testing were defined by the width of the deck. Funds were made available to extend the landing surface of the Griffin, at least enough to give the pilot some margin of error when landing in turbulent seas. Something of an investment under the circumstances. This preliminary work at least gave German engineers and pilots some experience in aircraft carrier requirements. In a time when it couldn't obtain this information from any other country, and when it didn't have a carrier of its own. Although by now the Zeppelin was well underway, it was far from completion, and technical data was vital. As the war on the Western Front progressed, one country after another fell before the seemingly unstoppable Nazi juggernaut. Frontline aircraft of both the Axis and the Allies were put to the test. A test that the Third Reich had been preparing for many years, but one that most other nations had sought to avoid, and therefore were often ill-equipped to deal with. Frontline planes were not the only aircraft at the Luftwaffe's disposal. Older type could still be gainfully employed. And this was true of older seaplanes and flying boats. It was just a matter of finding them a job that was suited to their limitations. This is an older model, Heinkel HE-59. It was still in service at the beginning of the war and used primarily for patrol work. Later models like the Dornier DO-18, a direct descendant of the Val, were soon to come online. They had much longer range, greater speed, and were more reliable. They were regularly used for observation work, often spotting Allied convoys on their way to Russia in mid-1941. Valuable information would be passed back to base and forwarded to swarms of Stukas, constantly on alert, waiting for their command to dive into action. Pilots would race out into the North Sea, attacking the vital supply lines that were so necessary for the survival of the Soviets. In the summer of 1941, they'd been virtually decimated by Hitler's surprise attack in Operation Barbarossa. To the Germans, the British convoys were critical. To the Russians, it was a matter of life or death. Another Dornier flying boat that gave valuable service throughout the war was the triple-engined DO-24. Larger than the 18, and with greater range, it could spot convoys further out to sea and could also perform invaluable transport and anti-shipping roles. The triple-engine concept, however, was never exploited by any nation as much as it was by the Italians. We use the configuration in just about every type of aircraft role possible, short of fighters. This is the Kant Z506 Heron, one of several triple-engined flying boats deployed by the Italians for patrol and bombing work in the Mediterranean. The Heron was a fast, all-wood aircraft. In fact, between 1936 and 1938, it captured a number of world seaplane speed and altitude records. It gave considerable service to the Italian cause during the war and would harass and sink Allied shipping on the way to North Africa, although their role was severely curtailed when the Royal Navy's carriers brought British fighters into the area. The great menace to Allied merchant shipping from 1940 onwards was the German U-boat, a thoroughly effective weapon for the disposal of merchant ships. At one stage, their crew's only problem was finding enough suitable targets. U-boat commanders ultimately got the assistance they needed from a somewhat unlikely origin. A pre-war German airliner designed to fly the Atlantic, carrying passengers in luxury, was hastily pressed into military service. A long-range, four-engined aircraft was required for lonely patrol work across the North Atlantic. From August 1940 to January 1941, Focke-Wulf 200 Condors, operating in the Atlantic from bases in Norway right down to the Bay of Biscay, worked in a deadly partnership with the U-boats to sink more than 360,000 tons of Allied shipping, with very little loss to the Condors or the submarines. Not a bad achievement for an aircraft whose design purpose was to convey 26 passengers in speed and safety. Had it not been for the advent of long-range British fighters like the Mosquito and the Bowfighter, the Condor U-boat combination might have brought Britain to her knees. Following the success of the Condor, an even larger transport, the Ju-90, another aircraft built for Lufthansa's civil air routes, was also adapted for military use. They also performed valuable maritime patrol work in their modified form as Junkers 290s, covering the entire eastern Atlantic from bases along the western seaboard of occupied Europe. The military version operated from 1943 onwards and offered the crew a reasonable level of protection from an assortment of gun barbettes scattered throughout the fuselage. Later versions had a tail gun position, something quite unusual for German aircraft. It's been said that Germany lacked a really good four-engined bomber. that it did so as purely a matter of leadership error and had nothing to do with its production capabilities. In fact, an even bigger version of the 290, the 390, was built with six engines. On one operational trial in 1944, it flew within 12 miles of New York City before it returned, without refueling. Although German U-boats had the support of long-range air patrols, they nevertheless lost the Battle of the Atlantic. Paradoxically, this was due partly to another long-range bomber, the American B-24. This aircraft could stalk U-boats with depth charges, sinking them faster than they could be replaced. Until the Allies produced aircraft like the B-24 and escort carriers, German submarines ruled the dark and icy waters of the Atlantic Gap, sending millions of tons of Allied shipping to the bottom and almost crippling the Allies. The Battle of Britain may have saved England from the Luftwaffe, but the Battle of the Atlantic was almost lost to the German submariners. Arguably the most successful of all German seaplanes, and perhaps of all the seaplanes used in the Second World War, was the Heinkel 115. This truly superb design often operated from specifically built flying boat stations, bases at which maritime aircraft could be serviced to any level of refurbishment required. The bases provided large gantries that could carry seaplanes far out into the water before releasing them, thus avoiding the alternative process of launching them from the ground, a time-consuming process that occupied many people and had its risks. You can tell from these installations just how committed the Wehrmacht was to the seaplane and flying boat programs. The commitment went further than just installations. It was also recognized how different the demands would be on maritime aircrew. Therefore, the crew selection process was more stringent and demanding than that for land-based aircraft crews. All of this effort was expended on the premise that seaplane crews had to be competent with nautical topics, every bit as much as those of an aviation nature. They were required to be masters of the oldest and at the same time the newest disciplines. This is a new class of crew members being made familiar with the HE-115s as they're serviced in their workshop. The builders of these aircraft also needed to be skilled in the crafts of the sea and air, and the craftsmanship of these planes throughout the war was always of a very high standard. If you look carefully at the man on the right, you can see his foot on a special platform incorporated into the plane's wing. Something that would be vital if the aircraft were being serviced at sea and yet never considered on a normal land-based aircraft. There were many other differences between seaplanes and land planes, which put added stress on those that serviced and flew them. Everything had to be compact and neat because of the very limited amount of space available, and what there was had to be well utilized. There are parallels between the life of the crew members on the long-range seaplane like the Heinkel 115, which performed its task flying above the sea, and the lifestyle of submariners who spent so much of their time beneath it. Both crews would have worked in confined, uncomfortable conditions with the constant threat of detection by the enemy. The limited space available in a seaplane dictated that all the equipment taken on board be selected frugally. But the hybrid maritime nature of the seaplane insisted that items like a megaphone to communicate with the boat party or a boat hook for holding dinghies alongside were always readily accessible. They were items that you would certainly never see on a land-based aircraft. For equipment not needed in flight, there were storage holds provided at the root of each wing. Here would be stored maritime necessities like lines, ropes, cable. More like a bosun's locker than part of a high-speed patrol bomber. In fact, these Luftwaffe crews were considered a breed of their own, having to deal with the new technology of aviation and the old demands of the sea. These men are stowing survival rations, brandy, chocolate, and medical needs in a sealed compartment inside one of the seaplane's floats. In the event of a crash, the watertight floats are likely to survive, and to a crew in the water, the precious contents would be lifesavers. Intelligent thinking by designers who understood the cruel sea. Although the 115 saw service throughout the war, its origins go back to 1936, when it competed with a Blohmann Voss design to provide the Luftwaffe with its first major single-wing seaplane. Heinkel demonstrated that its design was much more advanced than anything else available. In fact, it captured just about every major seaplane record in the world at the time. So conclusive was the 115's performance that the Luftwaffe had little choice but to accept it as the standard. The decision was vindicated by the crew's appreciation of an aircraft that responded so well, particularly in the difficult weather conditions seaplanes were often required to operate in. Not all German flying boat shore facilities had large gantries that simply plucked the plane out of the water and positioned it back there as required. Another method of launching beached seaplanes was simply to slide them down a concrete ramp that descended into the water. A simple but effective process which allowed the plane to be operational in a fairly short period of time. Important, given that both rescue and attack missions often came with so little notice. One of the main missions of the 115 was mine laying, often flying just outside enemy ports and along frequently used shipping lanes. There they'd make their drops, working under the protection of night. The precautions the Allies took to avoid mine damage tied up thousands of man-hours, resources, and much of the home fleet. From the German point of view, it was a very economical form of warfare, particularly against Britain, totally dependent as she was upon naval supplies for survival. Perhaps the greatest recognition of the success of the 115 can be gauged from these facts. In 1942, with almost 500 aircraft produced, the production line was run down to concentrate on other aircraft. But in late 1943, at a time when the German war effort required every fighter to be had, the 115 came back to the production line, because the need for continued supply of this 1936 design proved insatiable. Another aircraft that flew missions similar to the 115 was the tri-engined Blohmann Voss 138. It was not a seaplane, but rather a flying boat with a hull of reduced length, achieved by a twin boom design. The 138 was considered by its pilots rather a difficult plane to fly, with particularly bad vision on landing. But it did offer extremely long range, something that was vital for many of the missions it was required to perform. Here, the 138 has been fitted with a rocket pod under each wing to assist its takeoff. Experiments of this nature were conducted towards the end of the war, in an attempt to lift a variety of large aircraft into the air more quickly. The flying boats were given particular attention, as their takeoff time was greater and was influenced by the condition of the water. At takeoff, all aircraft engines are at maximum power and burning more fuel per minute than at any other time. Therefore, a protracted takeoff would leave reduced fuel and possibly have an adverse effect on the mission itself. Blohm & Voss were actually a shipbuilding company, which got into the flying boat business as an extension of its other activities. It's probably not surprising, therefore, that they also built the largest flying boat to see service during the Second World War. This was the BV-222, powered by six massive radial engines and called the Viking. This is the prototype, seen in its civilian colors. It was first ordered by Lufthansa as a long-range airliner to service the North Atlantic. But its military potential was quickly recognized, and like the Focke-Wulf Condor, was soon pressed into service. It flew transport and reconnaissance missions from Norway to North Africa. Although few were built, it gave surprisingly good service. Because of the number of engines, it had two flight engineers. The first engineer is sitting between the two pilots and adjusting the throttles. The second engineer sat behind the other crew at an elaborate console which gave him the vital information about each engine's performance. Helmut Röding was Blohm & Voss's chief test pilot and a man who brought a great deal of flying boat experience to a company that concentrated heavily on producing these aircraft. He would also have seen the project shift from a civilian to a military one. In later models, the lower of the craft's two decks would have accommodated machine gun positions, and there were two upper turrets. Despite this defensive fire, Vikings often employed escort fighters because the Luftwaffe were slow to take risks with an aircraft the size of the 222 and the cargo it was capable of carrying. The Viking's wings are of particular interest because they were formed around a main spar which was over a meter wide and also acted as a support for the engines themselves. The hollow spar occupied such a volume, it was logical to turn it into fuel and oil tanks. As big as the Viking was, there was one still larger flying boat produced by Blohm & Voss in the wartime years. This was the model 238. It employed many of the features of the 222, but it was actually 22 feet longer. Indeed, it was bigger in just about every dimension. Because the risk of building a plane this size were considered so great, Blohm & Voss commissioned a one-quarter size flying model to test its characteristics. You can see some indication of its scale from the workmen. There was even a tunnel inside the wing which enabled them to get to certain parts of the engine when the plane was in flight. From certain angles, the 238 actually resembles one of the many ships produced by Blohm & Voss. There was only one ever produced, and it took 14 months and some 600,000 man hours to accomplish. They also made the jigs that would have been necessary in a large production run, something that Blohm & Voss had anticipated. If the plane had gone into mass production, they calculated they could turn out a hull in about 8 weeks. So perhaps hundreds of these aircraft, with their six diesel engines, could have been available had the war continued. The 238 would have been more heavily armed than the Viking, offering a greater level of protection from Allied fighters. Certainly, the Luftwaffe must have considered this giant flying boat a viable proposition when work first started in January 1944. By the time the aircraft was completed in March of 1945, the war was already lost. And perhaps tragically, so was the sole example of the Tu-38. The largest flying boat to fly in the Second World War met its fate from the blazing guns of Allied Mustangs. It was destroyed just 4 days before the official end of the war. By any standards, it was a major engineering accomplishment. And that this was achieved during a time of great material shortages and while Germany was being bombed day and night speaks volumes of the ability of the Bluhmann-Voss team. As it happens, none of the Luftwaffe's warplanes ever reached North America, although it's very clear that they had a number of aircraft capable of doing so. By the time they came into service, the war had taken another direction, and the Fatherland needed defensive rather than offensive aircraft. It's a moot point, but one is prompted to question what might have happened if more of the German war effort had been put into developing conventional but massive aircraft like the Tu-38, which could have taken the conflict across the Atlantic to American soil.